So today let's speak about the windscreen models that we have seen in the last talk, and in particular we would like to focus on the diffusion rate. So first let me introduce you briefly the model, then I will state the theorem in terms of, as usual, procycle and transaction surfaces, and then I will try to give you an outline of the so the model is, so you play here with the plane, like that. It's not so interesting. And so you have to put some fancy obstacle. So for instance, you can put some obstacle like that, some small rectangles located at the Z2, at the integer point of the Z2 lattice. And you put all the obstacles periodically. So that what you see is something like that. And so you play here on the windscreen model, that is, so you remove those rectangles like that, of size say K and B in 0, 1, and you are looking at the flow, say phi x theta, so the particle starting from x goes in direction theta, it moves with a constant velocity and reflect according to the site with the elastic collision, as usual. So it's a nice dynamical system on the phase space, that is a unitary bundle of this VR, so I will denote it by WLB. So it preserves the Lebesgue measure. And as usual, you can ask your favorite question about this system. For instance, what are the behavior, what behavior could you expect for this dynamical system? So let me ask maybe several questions about that. So the first non-trivial question to ask is about the recurrence. Since the total mass is infinite, it's not obvious. So namely, you consider the distance in R2 from x to some, and you flow in some direction, and you want that you are coming back infinitely often close to x, so the mean amp over t is 0. So is it true or not? At the opposite, you can ask about the diffusion rate, so the diffusion. So again, so maybe the flow is recurrent, but maybe it's possible to come back very infinitely many times close to the starting point, but then maybe you will escape very far and come back and so on. And you want to know so at which speed you are coming going very far. So you consider the Lin soup of the distance in R2 for the same quantity distance, and I take the log, the logarithm over log t, and I ask what is this limit. I will denote it by delta theta, and I assume that delta theta is the same for almost every x. Okay, so I just throughout all the stupid direction. Here is the stupid direction. The vertical direction, because the behavior is not the same if you are here or here. Okay. And the other question you can ask, for instance, are about the ergodicity. What about the ergodicity? So let me give you some couple of results about that. The history, the coloring. So for the recurrence, the answer is yes. So the flow, so for any parameters, the flow is recurrent. So for any parameter, then almost every theta you have the lim amp is zero. Let me give you a theorem about the diffusion. So it is so all the experts are in the room, almost all. So it's the theorem by Delacroix, Hubert and Leliev. So the statement is the following. So for almost every parameters, MD, and maybe for the next, or for every parameter in the following subset, so I will explain maybe what is this subset. So it's E, this is of the set of squares AMD such that 1 over 1 minus A is equal to X plus Y square root of B. 1 over 1 minus B is 1 minus X plus Y square root of B, and B is some negative. Then, for almost every theta, the diffusion rate, delta theta, is too slow. Okay, so later, John Chaika and Alex Eskin proved the theorem about the genericity for in almost every direction for Nano-Seldes theorem for almost every direction, so that you can upgrade all the theorem about the Wintry model in this situation, and you can replace almost every by every. So the same conclusion, but with assumption for every A. Okay, but I will not use this in the test. Delta theta. Again, for almost every theta. Okay. So let me maybe say a few words about ergodicity, just for the history. So it is very funny because the behavior you get is at the opposite of the compact case, I would say. So for almost every AMD and almost every theta, which is the flow, which is downstairs or upstairs, theta is not, is neither ergodic nor minimal. And this is a theorem by Freitchek. I think you can also replace almost every by every by John and Alex Stewart. Okay, so this is very funny because so this model is rather simple, and it was studied a lot maybe a century ago by Paul and Tatiana Ehrenfest, and then later maybe 40 years ago by Hardy and Weber. And so it is rather simple, so that you can do a lot of computer experiments. And indeed, this was the case. And in all the conjecture, you can read in the paper, the two-thirds never appear. So, as you might probably know, this two-thirds is related to algebraic geometry. And the next theorem I would like to state, maybe try to explain why it was never conjecture. And so the theorem I would like to explain today the following. So theorem. So this is a joint work with Silva and Pascal. Okay. So there are some technical assumptions that are not really important because we are not good enough to remove the assumption, but let me write the technical assumption. For any AV in rational, say in Q, assume that A is P over Q, co-prime, same for B, R over S, it's not important, and P and R, P and R are, it's odd, yes, odd, it's odd. Anyway, then you consider the set of all possible diffusion rates in the circle, and what you get is exactly the full term. Okay, so in roughly speaking, if you shoot in a random direction for some invariant measure, what you get is something random.
You can't get one?
Yes, you can get one. I will explain that. It's a theorem by Forney. So it's roughly speaking, it's a Lyapunov exponent that corresponds to the exponent of the Kuntzewitz cocycle.
Sorry, you typically get two-thirds, but...
Exactly.
But you can get anything.
Exactly. For some boundary. So as we have seen this morning, maybe the next question to ask, the natural next question to ask, is what about the other dimension of the set of bad years? What is the other dimension in this situation? Or maybe what are the limit law in this situation? The set of theta for which the diffusion rate is less than something. Okay, so I will try to restate more precisely this theorem later. Okay. So as you might probably know, these are not theorems about the art. They are theorems about translation processes and cocycles. So let me briefly try to restate the theorem in terms of cocycle, and then I will give the main steps of the proofs. Okay, so as usual, the standard procedure is to unfold the VR along the trajectory so that you get the translation surface, and you can play with linear flow and so on. So I'm almost happy with this. So from this picture, you can unfold the VR so that you get a translation surface, say x, a, b. I will put some infinite somewhere because the corresponding surface is made of four copies of the original one, so that it is non-compact. You have a linear flow that I will denote by phi chi theta. The same notation is bad, but the same notation. I will put a hat here because it's we understand in a couple of minutes. And then I'm not very happy because the motto when you work with translation surfaces, as usual, is to use moduli spaces and renormalization. And so far, there is no good renormalization for non-compact surfaces. So at some point, I have to cheat. And now I'm cheating a little bit. And so this is the Wintry model, and I should say the periodic Wintry model. So this is a periodic Wintry model. And this is Z2 periodic. So I can first pass to the quotient, play in the billiard on the quotient, that is a torus, and then unfold the trajectory. So let me maybe draw a picture here. So these are the obstacles. So I'm drawing a fundamental domain for the Z2 action. Okay, so this is a fundamental domain for the Z2 action on R2. And you play VR inside, so you reflect according to the, as usual, elastic collision, Z. then you move to somewhere else. Okay, so if you unfold this beard, what you get is something like that. So you unfold it, and you get, I said, four copies of the beard table. With several identifications. So these are four tori with the following identification. This one is mapped to that one, and so on. And the same for the vertical side. Okay. So I will denote it by XAB. You have also the linear flow that will be denoted by phi, t theta, t theta. Okay, and now I want to relate phi and phi hat. So the schematic picture is following. So here I have X AB, Z2 cover, X AB hat. Roughly speaking, this is X cross Z2. I have a flow, phi hat, and basically the flow takes some point at some level, say M. It maps to the flow downstairs, phi of x, and maybe it will change by something, by a cosine. So it's M plus something. So what is this something? So schematically you have something like that. If you have a very long piece of trajectory for the flow downstairs, so this is P, T, X, vertical direction, pi over 2, what you get is something like that. Maybe you are coming back not at the same level, and so the next level is precisely the following quantity. I will denote this very long piece of curve by, say, gamma. Gamma tx, and you close up this one by a very short segment of length uniformly bounded by in terms of t. And so this is precisely the intersection number, the geometric intersection number of this path. In the first homology of the surface with some co-cycle, depending number of times you will cross the boundary of the fundamental domain, say f. And f is some vector in the first homology with Z2 coefficient, and in this situation I can write for you what is this f. So f is exactly, so let us call alpha 0, 0, beta 0, 0, the basis for the first tori, and the same for the other one. Alpha 1, 0, beta 1, 0, and so on. So 1, beta 0, 1, and this is, say, beta 0, 0, minus beta 1, 0, plus beta 0, 1, minus beta 1, 1, and something for you. Okay, so in particular, you can just convert the definition over there by the following one. So the diffusion rate is the limit, the mean soup of what? Of the growth rate of the norm of this vector. Some something very classical. And now, since I am in the compact setting, I can apply the classical ID, namely the renormalization process, to convert this quantity to a growth rate of some matrix, of some matrices of process. If I start with a translation surface X and the cross cycle, so X omega, and the cross cycle F, I can apply the geodesic flow, so G of S. So that I get a new translation surface with a new cross cycle that I will denote by B. S X of F. So what is this BS X? So there are several ways to see that. So G of S is a derivative map of some Teschmuller map between X and XS. So there exists a Teschmuller map. That is a fine with respect to the holomorphic one form, and the derivative map is exactly G of S. And so this matrix is nothing else than the action of this map in homology. And if you prefer, you can think of it, as we have seen in the first talk in the morning, as a rosy matrices. And this map may be the first auto map to some natural nice subsection, the rosy induction. Okay. So in general, it is rather easy to exhibit matrices like that by using the rosy matrix, rosy machine. Okay. And now, if I'm choosing the time nicely, so that, for instance, t E minus S is equal to 1. So what I get is a new translation surface, but the very, very long trajectory of length T, so it has length T on X, and the image by the Teschmuller map has length 1 on X. So that's again, I can convert.
Oh, it's a length t on the on x, and then you're shortening. Okay.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. And so that. So again, back to 2. So delta theta is the new 2 of so 1 over log t. So this is 1 over s of the logarithm of the norm of the growth rate of the matrices ESX. And so what we have to do is to compute this cocycle. Okay. Maybe let me give you an example that is in some sense more than an example. So in general, so I said that it is easy to compute matrices, but it's difficult to exhibit Lyapunov exponent like that. But there is one case that, for which it is simple, and this is a pseudo node of K. So, if the orbit GS between 0 and so I will put a T, I prefer, sorry, is closed in the Monelli space. Then closed, so maybe not simple, closed, then the length is T. Then so this map phi of T is a pseudonormal map.
So GTX is the closed.
Yes, this is a closed.
No, GT is, what is the notation? What do you mean GT is closed?
This orbit is closed inside the Monelli space.
It's an orbit, so it looks like X.
Yeah, what is it? Thank you. okay. And so in particular, wait, just would like to rename the. And so let me compute this quantity. This is a Lin soup over S of T, so over n, 1 over n capital T, the logarithm of this map, but this map is exactly the phi t x of f to the n. And this is exactly 1 over t delta theta is exactly so the derivative is theta 1 log theta 1. So t is exactly log theta 1, and this is the length of the closed geodesic. And delta t is 1 over t, namely 1 over log theta 1, log theta I for some eigenvalue. So theta I for eigenvalue of the matrix. Okay, and the topology. If F belongs to the say.
Sorry, what is the top line? Delta is what?
So delta is the diffusion rate, and yeah. This is this quantity. And so what I just say that if you apply the CS theorem to.
No, I'm sorry. What is your? It's equal to what?
Log theta 1 over log theta I, and theta I is.
Oh, that's theta 1.
Yes. And yeah. So if F belongs to the eigen.
Okay. Sorry.
Okay. Okay, so now let me just reformulate the theorem in terms of procyclon. So we have a very general theorem for this procyclon.
So if the phi equals 1, then delta is 1, right?
If phi is equal to?
If I, you know, if theta I, so
yes.
If I equals 1,
exactly, yes.
Which is generic case, right? I mean, usually the pseudo loss is going to be irreducible, right? So usually this would be 1.
Getting that 1, yeah.
So the pseudo loss of will give you 1 for the diffusion?
But F is never in the topological bundle, sub-bundle.
Okay. It's usually
theta 2,
but
theta
2 bundle.
Yeah. So it makes sense.
F is a 0.
Okay, and so let me state again the theorem with Pascal and Julien Pascal. So it's a theorem about co-cycle, as I said. It's a theorem about co-cycle on R2.
For what?
Can you explain what F really is? Like this. F is in some other lines.
For the Minkowski model, F for sure doesn't belong to the topological subbundle. So the theorem is the following. Let AT be a co-cycle over the geodesic flow, GT, on some hyperbolic surface. Finite area. So gamma is a Fuchsian group. I assume that AT is given by a suspension over the representation. So AT is a quotient of the trivial cocycle. Say AT hat over, so this is, so maybe, okay, so this is a unit torsion bundle of hyperbolic surface, that is PSL2R over gamma. So I assume that AT is the quotient of the trivial cocycle, namely PSL2R equals R2. Into PSL2R over the geodesic flow, so x u is mapped to gt x u, and then you model out by the representation gamma, so there exists rho representation of gamma into PSL2R. And rho acts on this trivial bundle, so I will denote it by E hat, by, as usual, so gamma is acting on x u by, so gamma x by Möbius transformation, and rho gamma, twisted by rho. Something so very classical, then the set lambda, that is a set of top diagonal exponents. Well, I will assume that this is the top, so lambda mu, this is the top diagonal exponent. for every new m of, say, PSL2R over gamma, that is a set of ergodic, I put ergodic, invariant probability measure invariant by GT. This set is an interval.
Okay.
Okay, so it's a subjective cocycle over the dimension of the model is 2. There are 2 exponents. One of them is non negative, and you take this one.
Yeah.
Okay, and this is the theorem.
I assume Roy takes unicorns to unicorns.
Not necessarily. No.
So did you use arithmetic? No. Is anything so?
This is
so you're doing squared line here, but it doesn't
look
to be.
Unipotent? No. No, I don't think so. Yeah. So I will discuss the proof maybe now. So first, let me.
So you don't use
arithmetic,
so you don't use
quantum. I use anything at all. It's a real term,
but your original theorem is also about.
And then I will explain how.
Both parameters epsilon also would work for your original theorem. Let's other parameters that are rich for the new.
Exactly. Yes. So yeah. Exactly. So thank you, Corina. So the assumption hidden in the theorem say precisely that the orbit of the surface is closed, so that the orbit is an affine invariant singularity that is precisely PSL2 over some gamma. So that
but you always state it for AB rational, but it also holds for AB in this epsilon
sense. Not completely. No? So let me explain you now how to prove the theorem. This theorem from the one from the cocycle.
Which
so this is theorem B. Okay.
The theorem about diffusion rates which is one is the series.
And the other one, okay, and theorem A. So theorem B implies theorem A. I will call for you the set of possible diffusion rate is your one for every A and B in Q square plus technical condition.
That's right.
Some technical conditions, so the numerator of the A and B are odd, both. So I will cheat a little bit. I will assume that A is equal to B to 1/2. And then I will explain how we can have the full statement. So, assume that A is equal to B to 1/2 for simplicity. So,
1/2 or 1/4? If it's 1/2, the square root of
this is 1/2. It works for 1/4, but not the same proof. Okay. So I first need a theorem that is due to Vincent, Pascal, and Samuel. So even if it is not stated like that, it appears somehow in the paper. So for any time, so maybe first. I need the first leg before the first one. So we have this Koncevich-Zoich cocycle on the first homology of the surface, as we have seen, x a b. It's a simple exercise to check that this is a group of rank 10. There are several symmetries that splits this group into several invariant subbundles by the cocycle. namely the one that is both invariant by horizontal and vertical translation, and so on. Okay. So you can restrict the cocycle to this invariant subbundle. So I get a new cocycle that I will denote by, say, GT restricted to E. Again, you can apply the Posidonis theorem to this cocycle with respect to any invariant ergodic probability, blah, 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 measure, the file. And theorem, so for every new in the set of ergodic invariant probability measure on the SL2R orbit of XAB, again, I assume that we are in the good case, so that it is a PSL2R over a gamma. There exists some theta, such as delta theta is the maximum of the Lyapunov exponent associated to mu on the bundle with this one and on the other one. So this is a theorem. Not difficult to extract from the paper.
What's the dimension of three plus minus?
This one?
Yeah.
The 2L2. Yes, exactly. Because so I expect that the same conclusion holds if you take a cocycle with value in R to the 2L with n large, but the proof is painful. We have to discuss at some point all possible Jordan decomposition. And in R2, there is only one possible Jordan decomposition in the hyperbolic case. But in general, it's more painful. Okay, so this was the baby step. The second step. Not yet. So, second state. So since n is equal to 1/2, you can redo the computation. So gamma is the following subgroup of PSL to Z. So this is a free subgroup. And in particular, due to this very particular case, lambda plus minus is equal to lambda minus plus. It's a fact. So in particular, it implies that the set of delta theta is an integral. So all I need to do is to prove that it contains 0 and 1 belongs to its closure. So the first point, 0 belongs to this set. So I'm cheating a little bit. So I'm using a theorem by Pat and Barak. So actually it's a nice result that chooses an ID of Thurston. So the kernel of the representation. So this representation is not faithful, and the kernel is very large. The limit set is a full circle at infinity. In particular, the kernel so is not trivial. So that you can get, so there are many pseudo-anosov elements. In the kernel. And so in particular, what are the Lyapunov exponents associated to the invariant measure supported on the periodic orbit? It's easy. So lambda plus minus, that is also lambda minus plus. This is a logarithm of the spectral radius of the Teschner map, or the pseudo-Anosov map restricted to this bundle, so theta plus minus over the logarithm of theta plus plus. That is exactly zero, since the action is trivial here, and this is one. So that you get zero so far. But I'm cheating a little bit because I'm using this theorem that is not explicit at all. And so it will be a zero. Rho is a representative. Ah. Yes, thank you. So rho. So gamma in this situation is a V group, SL of X omega, X A V, one half. And so rho so you take some element gamma, you consider the associate affine map. You look at the affine map on the homology and you restrict it to this invariant bundle. And I'm claiming that this restriction is a trivial for many elements.
But not necessarily at the same time in plus minus and
minus. Yes, exactly. In this situation, this is the same for some symmetry. Okay, so I get zero in the diffusion rate for free. And the third step is to show that one belongs to the closure of this set. So it's and do the product. So I consider two parabolic elements, say alpha and beta in the lead group. So the trace of the product is 2 plus alpha beta. I assume that alpha beta is greater than, it's not negative, it's positive, sorry. So that the product is hyperbolic. If I do n times this one, what I get is something like that. So the trace is, roughly speaking, n times alpha beta. But this is also the theta, the first eigenvalue of the associated Teschner map, plus 0.1. And since n is large enough, this one is close to zero, so this is, again, almost theta 1. Yeah. Good, I would say theta. Okay, and so in particular, the Lyapunov exponent associated to this family of pseudo-Anosov map is equal to log of theta 1, theta 2, sorry, theta plus minus, over log theta plus plus. Just look at it goes to 1 when n goes to 1. Okay. Okay. So this.
This is.
In general, yes. So if you have two matrices, so the trace roughly speaking, is comparable to the eigenvalue of the 2x2 matrix. And you apply the same argument on SL2R for the group gamma and for the image of gamma. So roughly speaking, this is log n over the plus and quotient over this. And this is log n, yes, this is important. Okay, and that's it. So prove the theorem in this particular case. Okay, so let me say a few words about the general case, and you will see why it is complicated, but much more complicated, and why we need the stupid assumption, I should say. So obviously, not obviously, but I expect that the theorem is still true if we remove the assumption, but so far I have no proof for that.
Sorry, which assumption is?
Assumption about the
Q cube,
the yes, P and R for the numerator of N.
So in general,
in the general case, okay, so I consider the set of
so what did you use for the example?
The orbit is closed.
The orbit is closed. So
in theorem B, you have.
So,
wait a minute, Paul. And you will see. So you consider the set of, again, PSL2R without measure over the. Ergodic, invariant measure, and so on. And so you have a map to the square. And I consider the top Lyapunov exponent as related to the bundle E plus minus. And the bundle, and the other bundle. And then I consider the maximum of these two quantities. To 0. So in the particular case, one half, what I get is something, so the image of this map is something in the diagonal, but in general, I don't know. This is something much more complicated. So if I apply Searson's theorem, or the theorem discovered by Pat and Barak, I have many elements here. So this belongs to the image. To the kernel of the first representation. The same is true for the other representation. Okay. Now if I apply the stupid argument, this one, I can apply it coordinate by coordinate, so that you have many points that convert this to one. And there is a nice result by Yves Benoit. That is the following. So it's a very general result, but let me state it in this particular case, just for simplicity. So let gamma in SNR, there is P. I will denote by L gamma the limit cone. This is you consider the set of all half line. So this is a logarithm of theta 1 greater than theta 2 and so on. So the logarithm of all eigenvalues of element gamma, or any element gamma in gamma, okay, sorted in this order, and you consider the closure of this set. I claim that the theorem says that this is a convex subset of the associated Weyl chamber. CNN. So in particular, the closure of the image of this map is something like that. It's a convex subset. So it's something like that. Okay, or maybe something like that. I don't know. Maybe it is something like that. It depends. Either you have points here and here, so that you have something that. So by the same argument, I explain you can convert each time you have a point that is not in the kernel of one orientation, but that is in the kernel of the other one. You can convert this to this point. So the three different pictures you get is this one, or the two different pictures you get are this one or this one. And the difficult point is how to show that the kernel of the two representations are not transverse somehow. And this is exactly where we use the assumption about A and B. And so let me, okay.
Oh, one question. So you use the graph for which big nodes? It looks like SL2 crosses SL2, so I don't understand why. Where is gamma here?
So gamma, okay. So gamma is here. This is SL2L. Okay, so you have the geodesic flow.
But you're mapping, aren't you mapping into two products of.
Exactly.
Into a product.
So I have two representations, rho plus minus and the other one. And for each representation, I can apply the theorem we have. And so, and also your theorem. So what I get is basically. Interval for each coordinate.
My question is this, you stated the theorem of Benoit for SL and R.
Yes.
But it seems to me that this diagram is in a picture in SL2 cross SL2, so.
In SL2
cross
SL2. It is not the SL2. Okay, so I'm cheating a little bit. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Okay.
Benoit also works for.
But you apply the projections to the factors. Up to now, that's what.
No, he's taking the convex hull in the.
The convex hull of the image. Okay, so maybe let me finish, and then I will discuss later about that. And so how we prove that the kernel are not transverse? We use the notion of good cylinder. So it's a notion that appeared first in the work by Aria and Hubert. So maybe in one sentence, so what is a good cylinder? A good cylinder on the surface is a cylinder that doesn't meet the course cycle F. So this is a cylinder that lifts to the wind tree model into a collection of cylinders. So when you have such a cylinder, so in particular the core curve doesn't intersect element of the two representation, E plus minus and E minus plus. And so in particular the den twist along the cylinder acts trivially on this bundle. Okay. And so in particular it gives you for free many elements, many explicit elements in the kernel. And so that we have this property. But unfortunately, two cylinders do exist. Only, it's a little bit technical, but only in, say, orbit A of square type surfaces. So it appears in the work by Pascal and Samuel and Kurt McMillan. Or equivalently, orbit A corresponds precisely to square type surfaces for which the corresponding parameter A and B satisfy this stupid condition. Okay. So I try to check to compute the kernel for various other parameters that correspond to big surfaces, non-arithmetic big surfaces, or arithmetic but in orbit B, and the Turing poles. There are many elements in both kernels. So probably the theorem is true, but we are not able to prove it. And so let me maybe I think I am over time. So maybe how many time do I have? Okay, well, so maybe I will stop here. Okay, so maybe say a few words about the proof. So there are several steps for proving this theorem about co-cycles. So the first one is to do a symbolic coding. So it's possible to do a symbolic coding, namely you replace the geodesic flow on the unit of bundle of this interbody surface by a full shift over two symbols. So this is nice because we can do computation by hand. And it's easier than to play with co-cycle. Then we have a theorem about fixed point. So maybe I will just state the theorem or the theorem because it is really beautiful. Assumption given by a representation that preserves a continuous sub-bundle, continuous one dimensional sub-bundle, then maybe I need to introduce more notation for that. Okay, so we have a symbolic coding, then we have a kind of a mean values theorem to prove that if for this coding, so we can replace this one by a full shift over two symbols, and this map will become continuous with respect to the x and y coordinates, so that the composition is continuous, and so that the image is an interval because this one is arcwise connected. The set of ergodic invariant measure on the full shift over two symbols is ergodic, is connected, arcwise connected. And so the question related to this one is, what is the image of this map? So I expect that it is a Peano curve, something very complicated in the square, or maybe the full square, I don't know. I have really no idea about that, but it's an interesting question. Thank you for your attention.
So the theta which was what you say in the kernel about the yes. Plus minus one plus.
Mm-hmm. Is it for the it's a good
so
this is
Thank you for the question.
Yeah. More questions?